Oh, Fred, what have you done now?
Any interference with this spaceship will be regarded as an act of war.
If our Singapore tracking station is correct about the rocket not landing in Russia, then where did it land?
This is the big one, 007.
Good evening.
We assume it's Japan.
Welcome to Japan, Mr. Bond. And how do you like our country so far?
Well, at least he died on the job.
He'd have wanted it this way.
Rubbish. Bond is alive.
Request permission to come aboard, sir.
Are the Japanese equipped to launch such a rocket?
That's what you've got to find out, and fast.
I am a trifle disappointed at the ease with which I could pull you in.
Get him.
Get down!
I never take any risks.
I think you are taking one now.
I am.
This damn thing could blow up into a full-scale war.
I think I will enjoy very much serving under you.
For a European, you are exceptionally cultivated.
You will see that my piranha fish get very hungry. They can strip a man to the bone in 30 seconds.
Bon appetit.
I've got you now.
Well, enjoy yourself.
James Bond, allow me to introduce myself. I am Ernst Stavro Blofeld. They told me you were assassinated in Hong Kong.
Yes, this is my second life.
You only live twice, Mr. Bond.
All the things I do for England.
Caesar, gentlemen, all we can do now is wait and pray.
Kill Bond, now!
You have a lot of energy for a dead man, Mr. Bond.
Hello, everybody, and welcome to Bond, James Bond, with your host, Mike Kalinowski, and myself, Brad Gilmore, promoting our brand new book, Bond, James Bond, exploring the shaken and stirred history of Ian Fleming's 007. This will be a limited podcast series that will dive into every single James Bond movie, and we will break them down. We will give our opinions, our hot takes, or whatever comes across our mind in the world of MI6's greatest secret agent, James Bond, 007. We hope that you enjoy the podcast, so much so that you go to bondjamesbondbook.com and order our brand new book, available on bondjamesbondbook.com or wherever books are sold. Let's enjoy the podcast. Everybody, we are back here on Bond, James Bond, going through each of the Bond films one at a time, talking about our thoughts and also, promoting our book that's coming out or is out by the time you're hearing this, probably called Bond, James Bond, exploring the shaken and stirred history of Ian Fleming's 007. And today we're going to be talking about You Only Live Twice. You can go get our book, the bondjamesbondbook.com. Here's the thing. Titling a book is kind of difficult, isn't it?
Well, you had more experience than I did, but this was the everything that went into it, I didn't want to think about it. I think you and I settled on one early on. I'm like, yeah, that's a great title. Mm-hmm. We did a little tweaks on it, and then, publisher came back. It's like, yeah, it doesn't test well. And then, what was the one we wanted? It was was it Shaken and Stirred?
I think it was Shaken and Stirred.
Exploring the highs and lows of Agent 007.
Yeah.
And they made so much sense. When people look up Shaken and Stirred, they think a bar book, a mixology book.
Right.
And that's what they think. And it's like, I didn't even think about that, but that's why they have their job. And that's what they do.
I know. Yeah. You don't think of these things.
Nope.
I don't remember if I had any other one backups for the Back to the Future book, Back from the Future, because it really hit all the keywords.
But yeah, hit right away.
You don't realize, because when I think you came out Shaken and Stirred, and I was like, God, what a great title. Awesome. You know, it's
it made sense because, like, we were, you know, it wasn't just going to be a love fest for Bond. Well, like, there's things to critique about Bond, just like anything. And we were like, yeah, we're going to talk about that stuff.
Yeah.
It just hit real well. But yeah, the marketing was like, well, that doesn't track well. I was like, okay. Yeah.
You Only Live Twice is a great title.
Yeah.
That's something we should talk about too. Like, what is it? What Bond titles are great? I think that From Russia with Love is a great title. Doctor No's cool. Thunderball's
It's kind of like Doctor No, Goldfinger. You're naming the bad guys.
Right.
It's like calling the Star Wars movie Darth Vader.
But gold, just the word gold is very Bondy because we hear it at least two other times.
Yeah.
And but this one, You Only Live Twice, that sounds like that's a Bond title.
Yeah, like, what do you mean? And like your thoughts, like, what do you mean you only live? You only live once. What do you mean twice? How's he living twice? Yeah, so it is a Bond title. It's great.
Yeah. This one opens up with Bond in bed, to no one's surprise. And is he in China or is he in Japan at this time? Because or where is he? Because he's with
Japan.
He's with a woman, of Asian background, and I thought she said, "You think Chinese girl better, right?" And then he's like, "Not better, just different. Maybe it was Tokyo, right?" That's what he says.
Yeah, again, some
just
choice dialogue. You're just like, okay,
yeah, that's where we are. And then though, this was great. And as far as a cold open to a movie goes, for all the Connerys, this is my favorite cold open.
Your favorite one?
Of his series.
Yeah.
I mean, Goldfinger's cool.
I'm partial from Russia with Love.
From Russia with Love.
Goldfinger's cool though. Goldfinger's great.
Yeah.
I mean, getting the tux with the
duck
wetsuit. That's pretty awesome.
That's pretty sweet. But this one, just because of how it leaves you. He's in bed with a woman, very Bondy, and then next thing you know, the fold-up bed goes into the wall. People run in, shoot the bed all up, and then it goes into the opening credits. You only live twice.
Right.
And you see
it sets up what we got in a great way, going along with the title and everything.
But you just don't know. I can only imagine if I'm sitting in the theaters in 1967, by the way.
Right.
This movie came out in 1967. And I'm sitting in the theaters, and I see this is the cold open. I'm like, wait, what? Did they?
Right.
How do you get out of that?
And like, it's great to be able to watch these films back then because nowadays that would have been spoiled months out in advance. Like, oh yeah, the pre-credit scene, Bond apparently dies, of course, but he doesn't. Like, it would have been out there, and we would have not been surprised, and we would have been like, okay. But you watch this movie in the '60s, and that happens. Yeah, that's awesome.
Yeah, it was great. And this movie, again, came out in 1967. So there was a little bit of a gap between the back-to-back-to-back-to-back years, 1967. Yeah. And it was a $9.5 million budget. So we got it inflated a little bit from last time. And $111 million at the box office. So down. This movie was down.
That goes to what we were saying with Thunderball. We're like, because Thunderball was so successful, but it's like, okay. Well, the audience is like, oh, all right, not as good as Goldfinger. Maybe we won't come back for the next one.
Yeah, this one again. I think this one is actually, in my opinion, I like this one more than Thunderball,
too.
Like infinitely more. Based on a Roald Dahl script, and Roald Dahl actually wrote the screenplay, and he's the guy who did Charlie and the Chocolate Factory and the BFG and James and the Giant Peach, all those books. He wrote the screenplay for this movie. This is, again, where I think a lot of the Austin Power tropes come from, because I'm pretty sure I saw Austin Powers at this point before I saw this particular movie. And when you see Dr. Evil in his volcano lair with his cat, it's You Only Live Twice. It's all out of this movie.
Yeah. See, I had seen You Only Live Twice many, many times for Austin Powers. So for me, it was like, wasn't as a... I don't say shocking, like as someone that would see an Austin Powers first and then see this, you're like, oh, that's exactly the movie.
Yeah. Yeah.
But I mean, just the design of that volcano, you know, it's awesome. Like, just awesome. That little Nelly, like, come on, that was incredible.
Again, we talk a lot about Ken Adam and what he was able to put together in the 1960s. And sometimes you look back at that era and how quality things are, and wonder, how did they do this at the time before, you know, they were cutting film, literally cutting it, you know, putting it together and figuring out how to shoot on color and audio and the different camera cuts. And it really, it was brilliant filmmaking. These movies really were.
I don't want to give it away because you might do it in the trivia, but I know we talk about it in the book. They had a hard time lighting the set for this. And a very famous filmmaker came in and helped them.
Yes.
With some ideas. So check it out in the book.
We'll save that one for the book because that's a really interesting story.
That was something I had no clue. And that I'd was never the great heard thing that about writing this book is I like to think of myself that I know, but a lot of what I know about it is the film itself, like trivia in the movie of characters and whatnot, but the behind the scenes and all the people that were involved that were never had their name on a Bond film to help these films be made. This one in particular, like, oh, that's pretty awesome. Like Roald Dahl, I had no idea that he wrote this before, you know, getting into it. It's like, I know him as Charlie and the Chocolate Factory.
Right. You don't think about the behind
the scenes. And not the same type of film at all, but there it is.
No, but some like kind of like over the top ideas, a volcano, a lair is very, you know, Charlie and the Chocolate Factory-esque, Willy Wonka-esque.
That is true, yeah.
But You Only Live Twice was... There are certain things that I really like about this movie. And then there are things that, again, in 2022 terms, don't fly. Like Sean Connery essentially being an Asian man.
No, that – and you're like, what does that do for the plot?
Nothing.
I'm like, okay. And then the whole thing with Henderson.
Yes.
Charles Gray's in that. And again, I met him first in Diamonds Are Forever. And I was like, wait a minute, what? He's not the same character. What's he doing?
Yeah.
So that's always weird. Yeah, there's a lot of choices in this film that don't necessarily fly now.
Oh, especially. No. But we do get to finally see Blofeld face to face, played by Donald Pleasance, legendary Donald Pleasance in this movie. Do you think that he did Blofeld justice? Did you enjoy Donald Pleasance's version of this character?
You know, I guess I'm not a Blofeld guy.
Yeah.
Because, I don't know. There's the something about his voice is not as – it's like, kill Bond now. Like, so – but again, I'm no big fan of Christoph Waltz in the role either.
I'm not a fan of his really at all.
Yeah, I didn't really care for the whole Oberhauser making him his brother, stepbrother thing. I didn't care for that. I always find there's a problem where filmmakers always try and tie the hero to the villain in some way. And sometimes like, no, just sometimes the villain's a bad guy and the hero's the good guy trying to stop him. They don't need connections, but there is something classic about Donald Pleasance in the role, you know, but I didn't grow up on those films with him in the character. Again, my first introduction to Blofeld was The Back of His Head and Roger Moore. You know, that's all I really had for it. So it didn't really stick for me as much as it does for a lot of people.
So again, though, this is one of the times where we got to play a little bit with Bond in, not in space, but there's a lot of, I don't know. There's a lot of fascination, I guess, because it was the 60s and we hadn't gone to the moon to this point yet. But there was a lot of fascination with space travel and the space race. We even
Race was huge right around then.
Even Dr. No talks, you know, there's the whole thing about NASA and in that one. And then going to this, they hijack a spacecraft at the beginning of the movie? That's floating out there. They hijack a spacecraft, I believe.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And you're like, what? Wait, what? Like, again, Bond films always try and tie into current events at the time. And that, you know, this film was no different than that one. But again, you're thinking about it. You're like, you know, a series of the hijackings to provoke a war between Russia and the United States, which at the time was exactly what was going on in the world. But you're like, okay, makes sense. You know, again, like you said, not Moonraker level yet. We're not going out into space yet, but it was happening at the time. And Bond always kind of tries to look a couple years into the future, like what could happen. And you know, it is what it is.
Yeah, it is interesting, though, the Charles Gray thing that you bring up. Because, again, continuity-wise, obviously doesn't make any sense. And Bond was always very fast and loose with continuity. And, right, and you know what? A lot of movies were up until the MCU, really. I mean, even X-Men was very fast and loose with continuity. And people would die and then come back in the next movie, or they'd be replaced or whatever. There's new actors, there's this, that, and the other. So continuity wasn't always big, but it was an interesting, I guess they just liked him so much. They're like,
yeah, I was like, in when we were looking, you know, deep into the research of this, like there was no talk. It's like, oh, Charles Henderson was so great, or not Henderson. Charles Gray was so great as Henderson. We loved him. We killed him off. We wanted to use him again. We brought him back. Like there was no talk of that. Like among the people, there's no, so, you know, nowadays you hear it and like, perfect example, MCU, like Gemma Chan. They loved her in Captain Marvel, and they wanted to use it. Like, we killed her off. We wanted to use her again. So we brought her back for Eternals. And, you know, for the fans, they won't care. We'll just – different character. There was usually talk of that, and there was no – like they always like, oh, he's a talented actor. And we just brought him back.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. There we go.
And that's, you know that. What, though? I mean, Bond does it a few times, even if you go to Maude Adams, who was in Man with the Golden Gun and comes back in Octopussy. You know, they would do that at times. I guess I kind of like it to be a one-off, like even with Felix Leiter. It's like, change him every time. Who gives a damn? You know, well, up until, like, Jeffrey Wright.
It's I'm curious to know the future of Bond, of what they're going to do. If they're going to keep it, the continuity, like they did with the Craig films, or just go one-offs.
Yeah.
And we'll keep a couple. It was, but that's the thing. It's like, okay, we had the same Q, everyone. We said the same M. We had the same Moneypenny.
True.
So there was continuity.
True.
But then they didn't, it was so loose, and as fans, no one really cared. We didn't, why aren't they doing the same thing and bringing the same characters back? And what happened to the girl in the last film? We need to know. Yeah. So I'm torn. I kind of like standalone, you know, each one was a different mission and it wasn't building to some bigger thing, but I also like the Craig stuff. So I take what they give us and, you know, make decisions on that, I guess.
The continuity is where, even going back to, like, I did like how they, in the first three, you know, they had Sylvia Trench, right? In each of them, kind of. And then even in Goldfinger, that's where we got one of the classic lines where Sean Connery beats the henchman up, throws him in the tub, and throws the heater or whatever into it. Shocking. Positively shocking, right? So there are some loose continuity. It's just weird that Charles Gray ends up as Blofeld, right? I mean, he plays Blofeld after this, so whatever.
At least they try to explain. It's like, plastic surgery. Okay, all right, fair enough.
Well, I guess if that's what you want to, if you want to run with that, you can. You only live twice. Those, again, was the first time we meet Donald Pleasance as Blofeld face to face. But this was Sean Connery's farewell to Bond, so we thought.
Right.
Especially if you watch the Everything or Nothing documentary, which is great. I love watching that thing. I've watched it like seven times or more. It was to the point of, we talked about it in Thunderball, how he was the biggest celebrity in the world. And and You Only Live Twice, they were filmed in Japan.
Yeah.
They got away from Pinewood and they actually went to Japan. And it was just all over the place. He couldn't even relieve himself in the John without photographers trying to take pictures of him.
Right.
And it had an effect on the production even. Like, it's just, he wasn't happy. And this is where kind of some of the issues with him and Cubby Broccoli and Saltzman started happening.
Yeah, and Cubby had always said, and we'll get this into this in on Her Majesty's Secret Service. It's like, you're not a star until the people make you a star. Mm-hmm. That's what he said to, you know, Lazenby, and it's just like, well, at this point, Connery was a star. This, these, it wasn't like he was, I don't want to say bigger than the Bond films, but he almost was. He was on his way or at his way to be. Like, it's so funny because I know Connery as the older gentleman
right.
in the 80s when I met him in films. And he was still, he was a movie star. He just was. Mm-hmm. He just, Connery is, like, I don't really remember Connery of the 70s. And you look at his filmography. I mean, I know of Robin Hood, Maid Marian. That's about it in the 70s. But for me, the 80s is where all the films he did, 80s into the 90s.
Mm-hmm.
But I always knew him as a movie star. He was never not a movie star to me. This Bond and when Bond and him took off, it was like, yeah, he was at that point. He's like, I don't need this anymore. I want to do other stuff.
And thinking back about it, you know, you do 5 movies of Bond in 6 years. That's such a grind.
That's huge.
That's such a grind.
That's insane. You know, I'm sure he had his agents stuff like, hey, we can branch off. We can start doing other stuff, you know, and he always wanted to get into the point of producing and doing his, not directing. He didn't want to direct his own stuff, but you know, he wanted to stretch his legs. Like, I think like any actor would, you know, he's played this role, you know, five times at this point. It's like, okay, yeah, let's go. Let's do something different.
Yeah. Let's get out of here. Let's stretch the legs a little bit, especially though. Cause again, I think that this is where they start talking about how money was an issue. It's like, hey man, like if I'm going to be here,
right?
Like, can you pay me what I'm worth?
Yeah.
And it's always that weird thing from the actor who's wants to be creatively satisfied with what they're doing, but also monetarily speaking, it's like, okay, look, maybe I'm not as creatively interested in this anymore, but if I'm going to do it, can you at least bump up the pay to make it worth me
You guys are making X amount of dollars per film. You've seen films are the biggest things in the world right now. It's like, all right, you got to pay me up.
Yeah, and until Diamonds Are Forever, he wasn't even getting paid $1 million for
that's
any of
these insane
movies.
To me. Like, to think of what these films cost to make, to think of what they made, and again, marketing was different back in the 60s than it is now. Marketing is not half your budget or double your budget like it is now.
Mm-hmm.
They had to be making tons of money. Like, the money was insane, and for him to not get a piece of that, and the people were coming to these films for him.
It was for
him. It's sad to say it, but as we get onto the next film and into that back Diamonds Are Forever, we'll see exactly that Connery was the draw.
Well, it's just like, think about if they did, I'm trying to think of a great comparative to today's standards, but if they did Iron Man or what have you, and you know, they go Iron Man 1, Iron Man 2, all the way up through going into the Avengers.
Yeah.
And if they were to take Robert Downey Jr. out of the Avengers and put in somebody else to play Iron Man, like, what does that do for the box office? It's going to affect it. It's not going to be the same.
I don't know. Like, I'm trying your great point, but I'm trying to think
of a better comparative. What about Harrison Ford?
I'll say this. Okay, there you go.
As Indiana Jones.
Let's say you do Indiana Jones 6.
Mm-hmm.
Or let's say there's no 5 they're doing right now. Let's say there wasn't a 5, the Crystal Skull, they want to do Indiana Jones again, and they got a new actor in there. I don't think it does nearly as good as box office.
No.
For me, it's I use this kind of analogy. James Bond, Indiana Jones, the actors kind of, I don't know. It's tough with Bond now. We got to talk about Bond, like Connery Bond. It's, for me, it's not like Batman. Like, you could take any actor. I think you could probably use an unknown actor in the role of Batman and it would still be incredibly successful. I don't think the actor, people go to see Christian Bale, Robert Pattinson, Affleck as Batman. They go to see Batman. And if they love him, then it does even better and continues on better. But I don't think a movie's going to flop if you've got some unknown actor in it and a great film. Whereas Connery, I guess, was reaching that point. Like, okay, are we going to see Connery? Or are we going to see Bond? Like, the audiences are saying that he became, and it says to this day where people still, he's their favorite Bond. There's a reason for that.
Yeah.
There's a reason that most people, I'd say majority of people, and like, there was a poll, I don't know if you saw it on Twitter. It was one of the Bond websites ranking all the Bond films. And Connery was, of course, number one.
Mm-hmm.
You know, there's really no question about that with a lot of people. And it just goes to show what he did with the role, the popularity at the time combined with him. And then it proved it with the next film. you know, what yeah. happened.
So if this was going to be the final time we see Sean Connery as Bond,
yeah.
which it wasn't, we see him two more times, right. one more officially.
You want to talk about leaving the audience wanting more and going out on a high note. Mm-hmm. Someone didn't take that advice. Oh, and I guess, and we'll get into that towards the end of why Connery isn't my favorite.
Yes, I'd like to hear a little bit more about that from you. But this movie, if this were going to be his last, do you think that this was a good way to go out? Because You Only Live Twice for me isn't as memorable as his first three. Like if we look at the first five, the last two are nowhere close to the first three.
No, but on the other hand, I'll take this film every single day over Thunderball.
Yes.
So if you want to go out on a memorable film, you're going out on a film that is the genesis of Austin Powers. It's the one that people remember. There's a lot of stuff that doesn't work in it, like the Asian switch. I think the Bond women in this film are a little, you know, the one like, you don't want to marry me and this and that. Like, it's like, okay, this is... Yeah, bad stereotyping and stuff. But there's just some great Bond stuff in the film. As opposed to Thunderball, where it's just like, that's okay. So I think it's better than Thunderball, but it's nowhere near Goldfinger. Like, if he left on Goldfinger, he left at the table. Well, people say, you still have money on the table. But he would have left going, hey, I'm out. I left it as good as it's ever going to get. See ya.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know.
Yeah.
Yeah, you could see him not wanting to leave after Goldfinger, though. Like, yeah. I don't know.
It's okay, a weird one.
Okay, Brad, I'll say this for you. This would be like if Craig left after Spectre and didn't do No Time to Die.
Right.
Like, No Time to Die. If people have faults with it, whatever, you know, but you can't fault it's an infinitely better film than Spectre. And it leaves him in a great – regardless of closing his story, it's a much better film than Spectre.
I agree. So I definitely see what you're saying.
Go out on that high note.
Mm-hmm.
So for him with this one, you know, this would have been a little bit more of a high note that for me as a fan, but creatively in box office and theatrically, I don't know, you know, if it was as much. So.
So here is some trivia for You Only Live Twice. It's interesting to me. The henchman Bond fights in Osato's office was played by Samoan pro wrestler, the High Chief Peter Maivia, who is the grandfather of Dwayne The Rock Johnson.
Really?
Yes. Yes.
Damn.
So look at that. The Rock, which, by the way, some people have floated the idea of the Rock being the next James Bond.
Are you out of your damn mind?
Which
I love The Rock.
Yes, he's great. It's perfect.
There is never a man that I would never actor that I'd love to sit down and just have a beer with and talk with than The Rock.
Mm-hmm.
Seems like one of the most charming, genuine people in the world. As a Bond, as James Bond, absolutely not.
No, that's not.
And don't even put Tom Holland out there, please.
I don't
for that either.
No, the volcano set cost as much as Dr. No's entire budget. Okay. It was so large it could be seen from 3 miles away. Is how big that set was. Ooh. Wow, that's incredible.
Damn.
And it speaks to the fact of how much success these movies have had in 6 years to go from my entire budget for Dr. No was this, and now I can only build a volcano set for what I paid to make the whole movie.
Yeah.
Nuts.
The only thing I can think of, Brad, for me to equate to, because you see all the pictures of the premieres of these films and the people lining up down the blocks for these things. The only thing I can equate that us in our timeline would equate to a Bond film and a debut was like the prequels for Star Wars, like Phantom Menace.
Mm-hmm.
Like that to me, I remember just the waiting in line and the hours in line to get in to see Star Wars again. I would think would come close to what it was like back then to be a Bond fan and waiting for the next Bond film and just these lines of people everywhere for these films.
Yeah, it's pretty incredible. It's pretty incredible. Nancy Sinatra was the first non-British singer to perform a theme for the James Bond movie. It was revealed that she was so nervous about doing it, it took 25 different takes, and the final song used in the film was made up of the best parts from each of the takes.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, I really like You Only Live Twice as a theme.
Yeah.
I think this is a really good one.
Did, one of the ones she would, Diamonds Are Forever, right?
No, that was Shirley Bassey.
Shirley Bassey.
Did she not do two? No. But she had another hit, which was Boots Are Made for Walking.
Oh, okay. These movies, too many of them. I get confused. I was talking to someone the other day because they were asking about the book. I was like, it's almost been 2 years since we, like, from your initial reaching out to me to our publication date, will just be shy of 2 years. So to be sitting with that for 2 years and I knew we were going through the edit of it, the manuscript, and that's like these dates, the names.
I know they all mixed together.
They're blurred. I'm blurred. Is it Ken Adams? Is it Ken Adam?
I know.
Is it Derek Meddings? A Derek Medding? Like, I'm like, oh God.
I know.
So yeah, the names. It's not Shirley Bassey did three.
Mm-hmm.
Diamonds Are Forever and Moonraker. Moonraker. Yeah.
Moonraker.
I love this song though.
Yeah, this is a really good one.
I mean, for the Bond songs, there's, for me, like we talk about the films where there's like, oh, this one doesn't work. The Bond songs, they just all hit for me. Like they're all, it's varying degrees of great for me in these songs.
Yeah.
Only twice. It's like the cinematography when I was watching it again was really great. Like the shots of the Japanese countryside and stuff. That this film to me looks so much. This to me, I guess, looks different than the other films because it really just opened everything up more. Mm-hmm. Like they use these great helicopter shots a lot of the times, and they're in Japan, and it's just gorgeous. As opposed to, it really opened the world to me as Bond. As a kid watching these, is like a travel log. It was just really awesome.
It's funny that's what you bring up, because the reason why this movie was so different from the book is that Roald Dahl hated the book. He called it Ian Fleming's worst book and compared it to a travel log.
That works for me.
On creating the plot, Dahl said he didn't know what the hell Bond was going to do despite having to deliver a first draft in 6 weeks. So he decided to base the plot to be similar to Dr. No. That was his idea. He's like, let me make it kind of like Dr. No.
You're kind of ballsy saying that the role that Ian Fleming didn't know what he was talking about. His plot sucked. Kind of ballsy. A
little bit.
He's passed at this point, so I don't think he cared. He's like, well, all right, he's gone. So yeah, I'm going to say what I want to say.
It was kind of sad that Fleming never really got to see the success of Bond, because he died during Goldfinger, right?
Yeah, he didn't get to see Goldfinger released. So it's like, can you imagine? Like, he had success.
Yeah.
And they knew they were successful, but he didn't reach the heights of what it was. And it's so funny because, you know, Broccoli taking over and then and Wilson and Barbara, mm-hmm. you know, Michael G. Wilson and
Barbara Broccoli.
They're the shepherds, and they have been with it for so long. They were like the ones I got introduced to with GoldenEye, and they were always on the tour, press tour, and always behind the scenes. So Fleming is kind of, he'll always be Ian Fleming's James Bond, but you don't really hear his estate talk about it much anymore. Yeah. And I don't know if it's because, you know, they don't own rights anymore, or they're just so out of the picture because there's no more books anymore.
You know what's funny?
I noticed this with like Robert Ludlum in the Bourne stuff. He was still kind of talked about when the films were really kind of coming forward. But Fleming kind of gets not as talked about as much. But just with this book and his life, it's fascinating how much his life mirrored Bond and where it came from.
So it's funny that you bring that up, because I actually, I'm holding this to the camera. I finally got the Blu-ray for No Time to Die yesterday. And I was just looking at the cover, and I love the aesthetic of it, but it's just funny right here. It says, like, it's like, can you fit more words before the title? It's Albert Broccoli's Eon Productions presents Daniel Craig as Ian Fleming's James Bond 007. Like, it's like, do you need more text?
Man, and I see that, and I really did not care for that poster that they have Craig there. Like, because think about all the Bond posters over, like, the great art that they were always incredible, and lately, I'd say the past couple ones, it was just like a headshot.
None of his were really that great.
Nah, they. I mean, the Roger Moore ones were just gorgeous.
Yeah, they hit another level with Roger Moore. Yeah. Couple more trivia facts before I ask you about your Rotten Tomatoes here.
No.
This marks the fifth and final on-screen appearance together for Sir Sean Connery and Lois Maxwell in Diamonds Are Forever, 1971. The scene where the disguised Moneypenny gives Bond his travel documents at the port of Dover, Maxwell and Connery filmed their lines separately and were not present together for the short scene. So this is like the end of an era for Connery and Maxwell.
Damn.
Yeah. And then
no idea about that.
the final one, this movie was released 2 months after Casino Royale, 1967. This was the first of two times that two James Bond movies, if you want to call it Casino Royale, James Bond movie, were released in the same year. It occurred again 16 years later with Octopussy and Never Say Never Again.
And needless to say, it destroyed it at the box office. It wasn't, there was no, which one's going to do better?
No. Absolutely not. Absolutely not. But Mike, the final question for you.
Yes, sir.
You only live twice.
Okay.
What did it get on Rotten Tomatoes?
Because you said, what was, 87 was Thunderball?
87 was Thunderball. This movie, shockingly, the lowest to the this time, 73%.
Whoa.
Yeah.
73. So they really was, okay, so think about that. You go from the highs of Goldfinger. What was Goldfinger, 99?
99.
You're dropping more than 20% in two films, 2 years, or 3 years, basically. That's it's a creative. You got to see, they go, okay, we need to, okay, what's going on? Audiences aren't responding anymore. What's going on? What happened?
Critics said, with exotic locales, impressive special effects, and a worthy central villain, You Only Live Twice overcomes a messy and implausible story to deliver another memorable early Bond flick. So they weren't a big fan of Roald Dahl.
Was 73 or 72, you said? 70. Is it still fresh?
It's still certified fresh. You're 73.
Okay. So again, films today would kill for those.
Yeah.
Kind of numbers.
Yeah.
And but definitely some things are like, okay, we need to reevaluate.
Well, and reevaluate they did, because next show we're going to be talking about an interesting one, because James Bond will return in On Her Majesty's Secret Service. Mike Kalinowski, where can the people find you and follow you?
Sir, they can find me everywhere at Mike Kalinowski.
Same for me, everywhere at Brad Gilmore. We are going to be talking about the one and only entry of George Lazenby into the franchise on the next episode of Bond James Bond. Go to bondjamesbondbook.com and order our book right now, and we'll be back to talk about On Her Majesty's Secret Service.
See you then.
Oh, Brad, what have you done now?